Today we're joined by the founder of Monthly. They work with top YouTubers like Mark Rober and celebrities like Charlie Puth and Kygo to produce immersive learning experiences. And its founder, Valentin, is one of the most brilliant and chill people I've ever met. His hunger for learning shows up everywhere, from his past projects like Rehuman, where he learned 15 skills at the same time. Crazy. To the story behind Monthly, and to, as you'll see, his ability to connect multiple fields of knowledge like mathematics, algorithms, and philosophy together. So make sure you watch all the way till the end, because there's so much wisdom. All right, let's get started.
Hey, Valentin, let's just back up all the way back to your childhood. I'm curious, what are some interesting experiences or key lessons that has led you into entrepreneurship?
Yeah, if I really reflect back, a big influence was my parents. And when I was a kid, I always had like a big inspiration for me. You go into movies and I saw Iron Man. I was like, wow, Iron Man is so amazing. I want to do cool things like that. And something also interesting about growing up is my dad did a lot of challenges to me. For example, I loved playing soccer, but I wasn't that good at it. And then my dad challenged me, hey, challenge you that in 3 months, if you do 100 juggles, I'll give you like a certain amount of money. And I was like, $300. And for me at the moment, my record was 3, but I was like, okay, I'll accept the challenge. And I practiced every single day. And a week into it, my record was still like 5. And then like 2 weeks, my record was like 7. And it was very tough because you're trying every day and it's not working. But I kept going at it. And the challenge was that when I was ready, I only had one chance to show it to my dad. And if the ball fell before the 100, then like I wouldn't win. So whenever I felt I was ready, I was like, okay, let's do it. And then when I did it, I ended up doing not 100. I crossed that. I ended up doing 396.
Wow.
Right. So, yeah. So I like that was one instance where like I just started like a lot of things that I did. I always try to exceed expectations, and like it just taught me that I can learn anything, and if I persevere and if I persist, I can achieve things. So that's that, right? And then like your other question was like in terms of varied interests. I think because of this knowledge that I can learn anything, I wasn't afraid to try new things. And a specific story here is that I found this summer math camp in California. Then there was a workshop about computer science and coding. And once I saw that, I was like, this is what I'm looking for. So after I started watching a lot of YouTube videos, like 4 or 5 hours of the day, and I just learned everything in like the 2 weeks. And so within 2 years of not knowing that programming existed, I was taking multivariable calculus at Harvard, and then I had 6 apps in the App Store. So I really went crazy in terms of like the slope. And this goes into a phrase that I love to say in this mental model is a little bit of slope makes up for a lot of y-intercept, right? It doesn't really matter where you are in the y-intercept scale, like where you currently are. If you start lower, but you have a much bigger slope, the line, it'll surpass the one that started above, but has not a big slope, right? And this also builds up upon, there's just like regular slope, but also exponential sloping. And you can become better at becoming better. And another model here is that like, that's how knowledge works. Knowledge compounds, right? Like if you think of your knowledge as a tree and you have like a lot of different branches and leaves, whenever some new piece of information comes around, you can connect it to a lot more things because you have more things. So the more things that you have, the more that you can learn.
Yeah, I find what you said there really interesting about the slope mattering much more than the y-intercept, or even the slope of the slope having exponential trajectory is way better than just a linear one. And I think that also ties into valuing people as well. When you think about potential candidates for a job, it's like, what's their slope? And can they grow into a better role too? Instead of thinking, like, does someone have experience? I think one extraction from that, but I think young age is a huge opportunity. I started my first company when I was 14, and that was huge leverage to be able to talk to people like you. So for anyone that's watching right now that's like below the age of 18, I just want to say this is like the perfect time where if you can demonstrate high slope, it just opens up so many opportunities, because a lot of people do evaluate people by their slope and not the y-intercept. Now, another thing, we were talking about your very early experiences and you saw Iron Man, you were very inspired. It was actually very similar for me, where I watched Iron Man, like Elon Musk videos, and I would cry during those videos. I'm like so inspired. I want to be part of that. what's more interesting is you cultivated this insane motivation and self-discipline out of your dad consistently challenging you. What do you think are possible ways for people to replicate that? Let's say if they never had the lucky scenario of their father challenging them, how do you think people can replicate that?
Yeah, I think you can create challenges for yourself, right? Life is just a blank canvas, and you can create a lot of systems for you to almost make things as a game, but towards achieving the things that you want to achieve.
Yeah. Now let's move on to after that teenage years and now into university, because I was looking at some of your existing content online and I saw you with also, you know, the founder of Speechify, which he's friends with Andrew Yang for context. They're all part of Brown. And then also I know your co-founder too, Max. He's also extremely smart. Also, do you know Matthew?
Yeah. DeMarc Antonio. Yeah.
I chatted with him before. He's a Thiel fellow. And it's just like the amount of connections, it's almost like the PayPal mafia that I'm seeing when I check out your LinkedIn. So yeah, I'm curious how you found your tribe.
Yeah, great question. And yeah, these are all like really close friends. Like I'm literally living with Cliff in this house. So Cliff is the founder of Speechify. And then Max is obviously my co-founder, and Matt, we're in the same year at Brown. So there is certainly some sort of like PayPal mafia thing there in terms of like all of these people working on like really cool stuff. But I think like in terms of like how we found each other, there was a lot of different methods and places. So a big like hack that I used to do a lot with Cliff at Brown is whenever there's a new year and there's a lot of freshmen coming in, we would just go to lunch and like just spend a lot of time just hopping between tables. And then I'm also listening to this book by Benjamin Franklin, where he talks about this thing called Junto, where he has a group of like smart intellectual friends that where they gather regularly. So I suggested that to a few friends, and we started meeting on Saturdays in my living room just to talk about life and interesting things. And we called it Junto, J-U-N-T-O, which means together in Spanish. And that was also an amazing way to develop closer relationships with those amazing people.
Yeah, I think would actually be a really good challenge for the audience. But then I realized you can't do this in COVID. But like after COVID is talking to a new person every single day, literally on the streets or on the way to the subway. I used to do that before COVID. And the actual value doesn't come just from the conversation, but it's like the confidence that it gives you to be able to talk to other people you're actually genuinely interested in. Because I think what holds a lot of people back from randomly hitting someone up and conversing with them is, what if it's awkward? What is it weird? So highly recommend like doing another challenge of just talking to strangers. Yeah. But also, I believe last time we talked separately, we talked about ant colonies and how that relates to social engineering and finding your optimal tribe. I'd love to hear more about that.
Yeah, an example is like ant colonies. What they do is, you know, the individual ants are not that smart themselves, where as a whole, they can be really smart and they can know where like to find certain things, right? So they use their external environment to aid them. And where this applies as a human personal life is just designing the environment around you, right? So if you want to learn guitar, having a guitar in front of you, or like meditation, having a specific meditation cushion, right? But this can extend also with their digital environment. So how can you create systems that remind you to reach out to certain people?
How did you came up with all the systems? Did you learn it somewhere via a course, or was it with your own thinking?
Both. I think what's important here is just take inspiration, like steal ideas from like different places, and then think about how can I actually modify it so it's better for me and have my own twist.
Yeah, I think that ability to be able to connect a lot of ideas from all different areas is so key in becoming successful, because by definition, I think that's how unique thoughts do get generated. It's much easier to generate unique thoughts by being an expert of two fields. And I think that's a perfect segue into your Rehuman project. So do you want to first give the audience just context, what it was about, and then talk about some of the key philosophies in there?
Yeah, totally. So my co-founder Max did this project called Mark to Master, where he like mastered a skill. And I thought, that's pretty cool. I love that. I want to do something like that. But I also love systems and habits. So I thought, okay, let's like create a single project called Rehuman. And re means is like reinventing, like recreating yourself. So the project was learning across 15 different skills and then like blogging about my process every day. This sounds like obviously is insane. So how am I going to actually achieve this? So I had certain things that I had as daily habits, and there's certain some things that were continuous, for example, like working out towards one arm pull-ups and the human flag. And then there's the weekly habits like salsa dancing or music production and whatnot. So yeah, it was extremely fun, and then led into like monthly, because we both love learning and have a lot of like personal experience in it. So how can we create the learning platform of your dreams?
Before we get into monthly, I want to double down on some of the points that you talked about and distill that into some key mental models. One of which you talk about, once again, going back to how slope is more important than y-intercept. And you talk about audiobooks, right? Like putting out 3.5x. I think now that you said that, it just dawned to me that it applies to a lot of other things. Like most of the time when we think about innovation or when we think about making something better, it's changing that, adding incremental change rather than changing the slope or changing the slope of the slope. And even when you think about like innovation, for example, like startups as a form of innovation, like the amount of people that are trying to innovate in the ways which we innovate are like very low, but Y Combinator is like a really good example of that. And arguably they have created much more change in the world than any individual startup because they've accelerated the rate of how startups progress. Exactly. And I think it also ties into why people get stagnant. It's people focus more on these incremental changes or the first level changes rather than these second level slope changes. I think we need more of that. Another thing I found really interesting was about your Rehuman project. The one hypothesis part of your Rehuman project I found really interesting was diversifying activities lowers probability of willpower depletion.
Yeah. As I was learning all of these different things at the same time, there were certain areas that were tougher to do. One of the things was like soccer trick juggling. If I only had that as my main thing and I wasn't really like achieving it, then I would feel like my life is not turning out well. But because I had so many different activities, like I'm progressing in my music production and I'm progressing in drawing. So like I got energy from these other areas, right? Because I was seeing progress in them, and I can take this motivation and progress and then apply it back to the soccer trick juggling. So it was basically lowering the probabilities that my overall motivation, energy, and willpower is depleted because I'm diversified.
Yeah, I think the underlying mental model there is expecting laws of diminishing returns happening, which is happens, you know, in all areas of life, but then overcoming that by diversifying, like you said, almost like eating one hamburger or eating the same thing over time, it just gets boring. But if you have multiple different things and you switch between them, it could be much more fulfilling than pursuing one thing. I think what's interesting about startups is that within the startup, there's also diversification so that it doesn't get boring. Yes. Like you might learn coding in the beginning to build an MVP. You hit that diminishing returns from doing that. Then you hire people and then you build a team, raise money, et cetera. There's always new things to be learned. I think that's a good mental model to think about in life, like what type of activities you want to spend your time doing? What are things that would hit diminishing returns very quickly versus things that allow a lot of room to diversify the amount of skills that you'll get to learn? Now let's talk about your journey in founding Monthly.
Yeah, throughout my life, my favorite thing is learning and creating things. And I also love, you know, startups and creating things and creating value. So we took a step back and then we thought, like, what type of life do we want to have? And for us, the answer is spending time learning and creating. And so it was how can we create something where we can live this life and enable other people to live this life as well. And then the mental jump that we did was who would be our ideal customers here? And then we thought our ideal customers are these YouTubers that we love watching, like learning from already. Why don't we just try to get them directly and like create a class with them?
Now, one last thing about Monthly before we move on to what's your future plans and where do you see yourself in the next 10, 20 years? I'm curious about the culture that you've built at Monthly, which I found really interesting. It's almost contrarian to the typical Silicon Valley, like work 80 hours a week. It was very much about learning and having a work-life balance. Every person gets free monthly courses. So I'm curious, how did you guys come up with that culture and being brave enough to take that step and be contrarian to the typical Silicon Valley wisdom?
Great question. For us, Monthly is about the things that you're learning outside of work. So we thought it was important to reflect that, but also it helps us think about our product, right? If we're living these interesting lives, then that informs us into building a product for those type of people. And it was also realizing that ultimately for a career, I think we have a life. And if you can like create a career that optimizes for the type of life that you want to have, then that's the better alignment to have, in my opinion.
Yeah, one parallel here that I remembered was watching this talk with the CMO of MongoDB, and she's also CMO of like a bunch of other multi-billion dollar companies. And she was talking about internal company marketing, getting everyone on the same page. So not only you want the marketing message to be spread outwards through websites, but you want the entire company to all know the message. So I think you guys did that extremely well. You completely aligned what the product represents with how you guys even operate the company, which I love a lot. The last question under here is, how do you go about enforcing this and making sure it doesn't slowly die down? Because I'm sure at the beginning, the culture is always high. Everyone's so excited to work, but over time, that inevitably, you know, hits the mission returns. So I'm curious how you overcome that and also manage different people, because for you operate really well with systems. For me too, I'm an ENTJ, and I think generally people of that personality type really love systems, but many people, and especially a lot of even artists who are different personality types, they don't work as well with very straightforward systems. So how do you, one, just reinforce that culture, make sure it doesn't die down, and also account for different types of people?
Great question. I think there's a lot of different ways, going from, you know, communicating it a lot, but also creating channels in Slack that reflect this type of culture, right? So we have this channel in our Slack hole that we call peer group. People are also sharing, you know, the monthly classes they're taking, and, you know, they've made this cookie from the baking class.
Yeah, that's got to be one of the best examples of one like product founder fit, but even like product culture slash team fit. The fact that pretty much everyone part of monthly, it's also a user of monthly. Like, that's insane. And I absolutely love it. Last part of this podcast is, I'm really curious about what you think the future looks like, one, for monthly, but also in your own life. Like, where do you want to be in the next 10 to 20 or even 50 years?
Great question. For monthly, we see that there's so much boundless potential. But 10, 20 years down the line, right, are there like physical spaces that are dedicated to learning? And I'm very excited about that. In terms of myself, I want to be surprised, because if you're learning in an exponential fashion, right, like a lot of people have trouble predicting the future because it's hard to predict that exponential growth. And that's how I also think about myself. I want to continue in this exponential trajectory.
Yeah, continue on the such an exponential trajectory that you can't even predict what will happen 10, 20, 50 years from now. Yeah, I love that. Lastly, as always, we have this bonus section at the end of every podcast episode. It's just very quick answers. Let's get into it. So the first question is, what is your productivity stack?
Great question. I love Notion. Audible for listening to books. I think, like, a lot of times the way they use the tools is more important than the tools themselves.
Yeah. Last thing, what are your favorite books?
Yeah. Oof. I think instead of giving a recommendation for some books, I think like the biggest recommendation I can give is trying out audiobooks. I think if you learn to listen, just changes the game, because you can listen to a lot of books.
And that's a perfect segue to Audible, the platform for audiobooks. If you want to get a 30-day free trial and read one of Valentin's favorite books, which is Sapiens, use my affiliate link in the description, and that way you also support this channel. All right, that's it.